ലോകത്തെ ആറാമത്തെ ഏറ്റവും മികച്ച സർവകലാശാലയാണ് ഹാർവാർഡ് യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റി. ആ സർവകലാശാലയിലെ സാമ്പത്തിക ശാസ്ത്ര വകുപ്പ് അതിലും വിഖ്യാതമാണ്. അവിടെ പ്രൊഫസറായി, പൂർണ്ണസമയ പ്രൊഫസറായി ഈ 5 നൂറ്റാണ്ട് നീണ്ട സർവകലാശാലയുടെ ചരിത്രത്തിൽ 3 സ്ത്രീകൾക്ക് മാത്രമേ ആ സ്ഥാനം ലഭിച്ചിട്ടുള്ളൂ. അവരിലൊരാൾ ഇപ്പോൾ മലയാളിയാണ് എന്നുള്ളത് കേരളത്തിനാകെ അഭിമാനകരമാണ്. അവരാണ് പ്രൊഫസർ ഗീത ഗോപിനാഥ്. പ്രൊഫസർ ഗീത ഗോപിനാഥ് സമീപകാലത്ത് ഒരു വിവാദത്തിൻ്റെ കഥാനായികയായിരുന്നു. മുഖ്യമന്ത്രി പിണറായി വിജയൻ തൻ്റെ സാമ്പത്തിക ഉപദേഷ്ടാവായി ഗീത ഗോപിനാഥിനെ നിയമിച്ചത് വലിയ വാർത്തകൾക്കും വിവാദങ്ങൾക്കും വഴിയൊരുക്കി. പ്രൊഫസർ ഗീത ഗോപിനാഥ് വലതുപക്ഷ സാമ്പത്തിക ശാസ്ത്രത്തിൽ വിശ്വസിക്കുന്ന ആളാണെന്നും കമ്മ്യൂണിസ്റ്റ് പാർട്ടിയുടെ നേതാവായ പിണറായി വിജയൻ മുഖ്യമന്ത്രി എന്തുകൊണ്ട് അവരെ ഉപദേഷ്ടാവാക്കി എന്നൊക്കെയുള്ള സംബന്ധിച്ച വലിയ വിവാദങ്ങളും ചർച്ചകളുമൊക്കെ അരങ്ങേറി. ഈ നിയമനത്തിന് ശേഷം പ്രൊഫസർ ഗീത ഗോപിനാഥ് ആദ്യമായി കേരളം സന്ദർശിച്ചിരിക്കുകയാണ്. അവർ നമ്മളോട് സംസാരിക്കുന്നു. പ്രൊഫസർ ഗീത ഗോപിനാഥ്, വെൽക്കം ടു ഏഷ്യാനെറ്റ് ന്യൂസ്.
താങ്ക് യു.
I just said that, you know, the kind of controversy that was actually triggered after you were appointed as the economic advisor of Chief Minister Pinarayi Vijayan. So one of those most issues that came up, that sort of, you know, made everybody sort of wonder was that you belong to two different ideologies that you were sort of identified with right-wing neoliberal economics, whereas Mr. Pinarayi Vijayan, the Chief Minister, belonged to the communist, hardcore communist group. Did this identities or this picturization of you and the Chief Minister as belonging to two different identities, did this worry you, or did this actually, you know, made you sort of, you know, think about your assignment for a second time?
So this controversy came as a big surprise to me. I was very surprised when I saw the reaction that came out, because I think of myself as a technocrat. I am a technocrat. I am a trained economist. I think about issues. I use my economic training to devise solutions. And so I'm purely a technocrat, and I reject all ideological labels. And to be honest, this term neoliberal really doesn't have a very good definition. It's mostly used when you are angry with somebody or you dislike somebody, then you call them a neoliberal, because otherwise there is no concrete definition to it. So again, to be very clear, I'm a technocrat. I see issues as economic problems. We all care about the exact same outcomes. We all care about upliftment of the poor people in society. We care about the welfare of people in society. There are different ways of solving problems, and my ways might be different from some others, but I don't see myself being labeled as any particular ideology.
Right, not even right-wing, left-wing economics. I mean, you don't believe even that?
That's now quite a bit old-fashioned in the way of thinking of on economics, of being extremely right-wing or left-wing. Nowadays, everybody spans the spectrum.
Now, let's come to the Kerala roots. You know, one of these important reasons for you being the economic advisor, besides your credentials as one of the most renowned academic, was your Kerala roots.
Yes.
Tell me something about that.
Yeah, so my family is from Kannur. My father is from Mayil.
Right.
My mother from Kuttiyattur. And I've had cousins and relationships.
But you never lived in Kerala.
So I never grew up. So I never lived in Kerala. But right. I spent most of my summers, summer holidays and vacations in Kerala. You know, my uncle, Dr. V.C. Ravindran, is a very renowned doctor and social worker in Payyanur. So I have very close ties with a lot of my family in Kerala. But more than that, so even if I wasn't physically brought up in Kerala,
that's
I think
right.
growing up as a Malayali family with Malayali parents gave me advantages that I've actually come to appreciate more and more over time. And I've said this before, and I've said this when I came for the Emerging Kerala Summit, that
right.
being born a girl in India,
right.
it matters a whole lot what family you're born into. And being born into a Malayali family, and a matriarchal, which follows a matriarchal system,
right.
I mean, I always felt you know, loved, and I always felt I had a high sense of self-worth. There were, you know, I never had ever this perception that I was second-class relative to boys, and that gave me confidence. My parents gave me all the education, all the health care I needed. Nothing was compromised. So all of that were blessings that came to me, and I identify that a lot with having
I remember you mentioned,
my roots in Kerala.
You mentioned exactly these things when you came for that, you know, that
Emerging Kerala Summit,
and in that speech also. Now, but were you surprised when you know when the Chief Minister announced, when the government announced, and the most closely guarded secret is that how did it come about? Who was the person, or what was the reason that you know, the Chief Minister picked you? Is there any clue about that?
I think you should ask the Chief Minister that question. So, I mean, all I know is my sense is that he wanted to step outside his echo chamber.
Geeta, in the statement that you issued after the appointment, actually you said then you will help the world knowledge leaders to connect with Kerala, to address Kerala specific problems. So that was an extremely inspiring sort of statement. But what is the state now about that? Do you have any plan for that?
Yes, actually, I feel like I have made progress in that dimension very specifically. So in the healthcare sector, for instance, there is a big policy push to provide comprehensive healthcare coverage. And I've been able to bring together knowledge leaders in globally to kind of focus on some of the issues in Kerala and to connect with the relevant senior people in the Kerala government. And I see that there is a very positive exchange that's going on. And I mean, I'm optimistic that something good will come out.
Is there any possibility to bring any global delegation to Kerala to have a sort of, you know, in-depth study about Kerala? Do you plan to do that?
I mean, I'm not sure. I mean, I think in overall, yes, but I'm not a big fan of bringing delegations and having conferences and things of that kind. But sometimes they come for one day, they come for 2 days, and then, you know, they say a few things and nothing much happens. I would rather, given now the way you can communicate remotely, I would rather have, you know, serious ongoing discussions on very concrete issues with a very clear path forward about how we're going to accomplish it. And I'm quite optimistic about the progress we've made so far.
After this meeting, the series of meetings you had, what is the next major step that you're going to say? I mean, are you going to take now? I mean, if that is
yes,
something
again,
you can
again,
say
I'm
about.
Going to be purposefully vague, but the good thing about these discussions is, before coming here, what I did was I initiated the process of generating contacts between some departments over here and overseas, and then I came here to see a little more about, to understand the issues a little more, and understand the priorities even better, and so I have a very clear sense now of which particular areas and sectors we can bring in people, and we can move this thing quickly, as opposed to this just being some, you know,
okay,
discussions, random discussions that don't end up anywhere. I really would like to see some very targeted,
targeted. And public
outcomes.
Health would be one of them.
Public health would be one of them. Skilling would be another one of them.
Right. Kerala has a very unique tradition, history, and all those things, because the Kerala economy, the Kerala development model itself has been discussed widely all over the world. So Kerala's problems are supposed to be unique, and Kerala's answers also should be very sort of, you know, very different from the routine thing. But
yes.
What is your take on Kerala? How, you know, how does Kerala fare in today's world in terms of its economic progress, or in terms of, you know, the way they actually should go forward? I mean,
right.
what is your
take? So you're absolutely right. The Kerala has a unique development model. It has put a lot of emphasis on health, education. It's a very large welfare state. And that has done a lot of good for the people of Kerala. At the same time, there has been a deficit in certain areas. like in job creation, the unemployment rate is one of the highest in Kerala's. So going forward, the issues that need to be addressed is how do we maintain the pluses of this very good system of healthcare and education, while at the same time bringing good jobs to Kerala that pay well, address the employment aspirations of the people of Kerala. And so that's kind of the two-pronged approach that one has to take, because as you mentioned, in the space of healthcare and education, Kerala is quite different from the rest of India, because it's addressed most of the first generational problems. It is now tackling the second generation problems. So among the second generation problems, you have the how do you deal with non-communicable diseases, geriatric care, because the demographics are leaning towards older people. So in that sense, there is actually a lot that can be learned from countries outside, which is from the other middle income countries and the wealthier countries, because they are grappling with the exact same problems. And so there is a sense in which the best practices that have been used there can be brought to Kerala, not in the exact same form, adapted to the specific needs of Keralites. But that's exactly the space in which I think I fit in, which is the fact that many of the issues that Kerala have are of middle income and higher countries. I have some expertise in those areas, and so the idea is to bring the best ideas together in this space.
But do you think, is there any one particular idea that is actually, you think, you know, after you came here, after you have been going through before, earlier to this, you came here to spend your vacation, although you were there for the meetings, Emerging Kerala meeting also, but is there any one major idea that you think that it would be wonderful to address some of these perennial problems that Kerala faces, especially in terms, I'm asking this because one of those problems that I've actually, Kerala has been grappling with the problem, in fact it's not a problem because the kind of money that is coming in from Gulf, the non-resident Keralites, because I think Kerala is yet to come out with a proposal or with a project that could actually attract this money. So this money has not been used productively, something which we have been hearing for a long time. So is there any single major idea that actually can leverage Kerala to a higher level?
Right. I appreciate the question. I don't want to go into very specific details because I feel like these are discussions that I have had and it's the government to decide what they do with it. But I can speak more broadly, which is the fact that the perception of Kerala has also got to change, which is that the perception very much is that while it is very good on social indicators, there are some deficits in the ease of doing business. In most measures, Kerala doesn't rank very highly. There is an infrastructure deficit that needs to be met. When those are addressed, when the infrastructure deficit problems are addressed, when the ease of doing business is addressed, then that will obviously change the perception for investors from outside to bring money in. In terms of another issue that I think is quite important is the matter of skilling. And the reason I say that is also from a kind of a more general perspective, which is that if you look at incomes that have grown around the world, the reason there's been a widening of the gap between the rich and the poor is because the returns to high quality skills have gone up so much. And that is expected to go up even more over time as we have become much more technology oriented, the so-called fourth industrial revolution. So that's going to make the rewards to having high quality skills very high, and the gap between those people and those who do not have skills even bigger than it's ever been in the past. So that's a space in which, Kerala really needs to work hard in, which is make sure that it's not just that you have a degree or you have an education, but it's high quality, of the right skills that are needed, and then can get you the rewards that you would expect. So I think that the skilling aspect for Kerala is a very, very important part.
You know that, Kerala's higher education, the standards of higher education have gone down like anything. In fact, we are never near even the best, 50 universities that, in the country, not to speak about the world map. But this is something which, Kerala has known this problem, but nothing much has been done. But you are coming from one of the one of the best universities ever in the world. So what is that, you know, you can actually advise to the Kerala state and Kerala government in particular about having a center of excellence or having a university of, if not in global standards, at least by national standards?
It's not easy to transform universities overnight. Now, there are different models in which it can work. For instance, the Indian School of Business is an example of bringing in faculty from other universities, you know, making it attractive enough for them to come and spend time here and teach for some period of time. That has worked very well for the Indian School of Business. So those are, you know, those could be initial steps that could be taken to attract foreign faculty, to attract indigenous to Indian faculty, to move the best of them to move to Kerala. So it would take place in steps. These things unfortunately don't happen overnight.
You know, there are so many slogans and protests against globalization, but yes. The fact is that Kerala is one of the most globalized states in the country. In fact, you know, much before some of the big states of India, you know, even heard about globalization, we were in that global map. Yes. Looking at the current global scenario and the kind of problems that the Kerala faces, you know, like, you know, Kerala is faced with a problem like, you know, there could be exodus of people from Gulf if, you know, the recession continues, if the oil crisis continues. That could be a major point of concern for Kerala. And you have this, you know, the Kerala spices and all those things that actually have gone down in terms of, you know, good pricing and good demand, in the sense because you have Kerala is because of the kind of the advantages have been coming from the fact that Kerala is globalized, as well as the disadvantage or the kind of challenges also come from the same route.
Yes.
So looking at the present the global scenario, how do you think that Kerala is going to face these problems?
So Kerala certainly has an exposure to outside events which rest of the India doesn't have. So if you look at the fact that Kerala gets up to 20% of state, in terms of 20% of state GDP, our remittances
exactly
from the Middle East.
Right.
So that implies that events in the Middle East have a significant effect on the Kerala economy. Exchange rate movements
right.
have a significant effect on the Kerala economy. Given that the Middle East is probably now, you know, things are very bad and things might improve somewhat in terms of commodity prices. There's very little expectation that commodity prices will go back to the days when China was growing at 10, 11, 12%. Because it's not very clear where the big demand for commodities is going to come. The expectation is that commodity prices will go up in the future, but I don't think many people are predicting that it will go up to the levels that it existed in the past. So keeping that in mind, we should look at this as what we call a trend shift. So this is not a cyclical thing, that this is a trend shift.
Right.
And it's important, I think that's why it's even more important to make sure that the Kerala economy is the source of income generation, is the source of employment generation. And that has to be on the top of the agenda for the government.
But over the last 20 years, you know, Kerala has actually grown from one of the poorest states to one of the most prosperous states. So actually we have both this. But there is an assumption that these things don't go together, in the sense equity on the one side and growth on the other. So do you think that this is a situation which is actually mutually contradictory or whatever it is? I mean, do you think this cannot go together?
This is a part of a very big debate that's going on globally, which
right.
is the about the rise in inequality.
Right.
But it's important to keep the facts in mind, which is that it depends upon how you measure your inequality.
You don't subscribe to the view that, you know, growth is, I mean, this is something which is inevitable, that an element of inequality
yes.
has to be there if
yes.
you want to grow much faster than in the past.
I don't agree with. I mean, there are Scandinavian economies that are very large welfare states that have grown without as much of an increase in inequality as many other countries in the world. And so, no, I don't see those two necessarily as a conflict.
Don't look for magic formulas.
Yes, don't look for magic formulas. Don't look for magic for me.
Right.
Given the fact that I'm based over there and I am doing my very best to contribute towards Kerala, but at the same time I want to be modest and I want to recognize that there are certain limits to what can be done.
Thank you, Geeta. It's great having you here and great having you as an advisor to the state. I think we are actually, though our anticipations and our expectations are not in place, I think Kerala is going to benefit from your knowledge, from your experience and whatever it is.
Thanks
a lot,
Geeta. Thank you.
Thank you.